Yes.
He's there.
Yes, I promoted him. May I start? Dr. Sarvadai, sir?
Yes.
Okay, yes, friends. Please, sir. Very good evening from SMU, Udgir, Maharashtra, India. Friends, in the beginning of the year 2020, the world might not have imagined that in the 21st century, where medical science has extended its wings so far, a mere virus can change our entire life and affect entire civilization. The whole globe collapse, whole system, put humans at risk and create chaos and confusion at each step and every breath. The pandemic caused due to COVID-19 outbreak has dragged us away too far from our regular and normal lives. Not only the rate of infection and the patterns of the transmission threatens our sense, but also even the safety measures like lockdown and social distancing, by refraining from doing what is inherently human, put us in a bitter predicament. It threatens the entire existence of mankind. It has spread fear all over the world, and we have no idea when can normalcy be restored. These restrictions are creating suffocation for us. This suffocation made each individual of this globe to think about it. The government and the are doing their all best to face and eradicate this global ill. This is time every one of us, too, as an academician, as intellectual group of the society, to think over it. We all are associated with literature. It is apparent that we have to think over what has been role played by literature in pandemics that took place in the past, and what should literature offer to address crisis. Perhaps the world may never go back to what it was pre-pandemic. We can count on it to adapt to the future, irrespective of what is content, and to have intellectual debate and discourse on it. We all are here today in this session on the screen. As a convener and the host, I welcome all of you. We have Dr. Akshay Sarvade from Kolhapur University as the chairperson of this session. We have Dr. Smita from UK. We have Dorotnath Gangne from Jazan University, Saudi Arabia. We have Dr. Praveen Joshi. I think he will join shortly. Dr. Ashok Chaskar from Pune. I'm not introducing, just I'm welcoming you. Dr. T.N. Kodekar from Solapur. Ankita Khanna from Surat, Gujarat. We have Basudev Paul from West Bengal. We have Seema Katiyar from Lucknow, UP. We have Thiru from Vellore, Tamil Nadu. We have Dr. Prashant Motte from Umaragar. I think that Dr. Gurav is about to join shortly. And Dr. Vishali, return. She's from Delhi. And special invitee, the head of institution of Shivaji Mahavidyalaya, our principal, Dr. V.A. Jadhav, sir, is also here specially. Vice President is also here. He is invited. The faculties of department of English, that is my department, Dr. Gutte and Dr. P.D. Mane are also here. And I once again welcome you all, and I request my colleague, Dr. Gutte, to introduce the first half of the panelist. Dr. Gutte, please, first half of panelist.
Good evening. I want to introduce the chairperson. Sir, may I introduce chairperson first?
Yes, please.
The chairperson of this panel discussion is Dr. A.M. Sarvade. He is associate professor, head department of English, Shivaji University, Kolhapur. His area of specialization is linguistics, new literature in English. His PhD thesis is on communicative concepts and communicative performance, a case study of PG students of. Under his guidance, two more students have been awarded under his guidance as a doctoral degree. And he has completed two MRPs, and one MRP is going on. So next, we have the panelist, and first panelist in our panel discussion is Dr. Smita Ray. She is a former faculty of King's College, London. At present, she is working in Hounslow Adult and Community Education, London Metropolitan University. She is a manager with a teacher and manager with the demonstrated history in education and management industry. She is skilled in research and development. Her research is social linguistic form in Metropolitan University. That she has done his research work on socio-economic class and learning English as a second language, a case study of Gujarati women in London. She has published a few books, We Somehow Survive, English Language Learning, Social Cohesion and Questions of Identity. The next panelist in our panel discussion is Sri Gorakhnath Gangne. He is assistant professor of English, Jazan University, Saudi Arabia. He has written a short story, Shalin. He is interested in reviews of the movies like Sairat. He has higher education in English, challenges of education in rural students, and remedies by the education systems. He has published several papers, research papers in national and international journals. Next panelist in our panel discussion is Dr. Praveen Doshi. He is a renowned educationist, director
at... He's yet to join, he will join soon.
Yeah.
Yes, he joined.
Okay. And he is the director at Prerna College of Commerce. The several students have been awarded under his guidance. He is even social activist, chaired several sessions and at national and international conference. Next panelist in our panel discussion is Dr. Ashok Chaskar. He is the professor, head department of English, SP College Pune, former dean and board of studies, Savitribai Phule University. Published books on multiculturalism in Indian fiction in English, doing research in literature and language, introduction to literary theory and criticism. Several students have been awarded under his guidance. He has always been invited as a resource person, and he is the guest referee on several journals. The next panelist in our panel discussion is Ankita Khanna. She is associate professor and chairperson, Center for Humanities, P.P. Savani University, Surat. And she is program coordinator for foundation course with School of Liberal Arts. She has 15 years of teaching experience at National Institute of Technology. She has explored psychogenic thrills in works of renowned poets as her doctoral project, authored and edited more than 20 research papers and 2 books, presented her 2 views in several national and international conferences. The next panelist in our panel discussion is Dr. T.N. Kolekar, who is the head department of English, Dayanand College, Solapur. He is associate professor. He has 25 years of teaching experience, published research papers, more than 60 research papers have been published in several national and international research journals, peer-reviewed research journals. 12 students have been awarded under his supervision for PhD. The next 6 panelists will be introduced by my faculty or colleague, Sri P.D. Mane.
I am calling my another colleague, Mr. P.D. Mane, to introduce half of the panel. Dr. P.D. Mane, unmute your mic.
Okay, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, now. Yes, proceed.
Good evening, everybody. I am here to introduce the next 6 panelists. We have 12 panelists in this session. The 7th panelist, Sri Vasudev Paul, Associate Professor in English, Parimal Mitra, Smriti Mahavidyalaya, West Bengal. He is the NCC officer and the captain in rank. He is a poet, and his haikus are liked by all. The next panelist is Dr. Seema Singh Katiyar, in English, Harvard Girls Degree College, Lucknow. She has a great enthusiasm for eco-criticism. She has edited one literary journal in English, and currently she is associate editor for two reputed UGC approved journals. She is the vice president of the educational cell of Bharat Raksha Dal Trust. She is also the joint secretary of FSLE India for its Uttar Pradesh central region. Her major area of concern incorporates with the LEGH issues. Our next panelist is Dr. Sadashivam Thiruvannavekkarasu, assistant professor, Muthurangam Government Arts College, Vellore, Tamil Nadu state. Experienced assistant professor with a demonstrated history of working in the education management industry, skilled in curriculum development, public speaking, teacher training, research and educational leadership, strong educational professional with a PhD focused in English literature from Gandhigram Rural Institute, Dandigal. Our next panelist, Dr. Prashant Mote, faculty, Department of English, Adarsh Senior College, Umarga, Maharashtra State. He has published 5 books and various research articles in national and international referred journals. He is the editor-in-chief of Langlet, an international peer-reviewed open access journal. Our next panelist, Dr. Mohini Gurav, faculty, Department of English, Sandeep University, Nashik. She is a poetess. Poetry writing is her passion. Some of her poems are published in anthologies like First, Scaling Heights, edited by Gopal Lahiri and Kirti Sengupta. Next anthology, due by Forum for Creative Writers. Next anthology, Women Poets, Within and Beyond Shores, published by Author Press. Her poem, Waves, got selected for the 10th International Poetry Festival. Our next and the last panelist is Dr. Vishali Sharma, faculty, Department of English, Sharda University, Greater Noida, New Delhi. She has worked as a book review editor and associate editor for reputed international journals and has experience in teaching English literature at graduation and post-graduation levels and English language to international students. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mani. Dr. Akshay Sarawde, now I would like to hand over the charge of the session to you. I appeal you to session. Meanwhile, just the participants already are joining. We will check in our Q&A if any question is there, and that we will take here for consideration. Now you open the topic for discussion and appeal all to contribute first on the basic point that what is the role of the literature in this pandemic or this type of pandemics or such types of time of crisis. Dr. Sarawde, handing over session.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Well, I at the outset I thank the organizers for inviting me in this panel discussion and making me the chairman of this session. Similarly, I welcome all the panelists. Well, as in fact, Dr. Navle has taken a very timely step by organizing this webinar on the topic of literature or the role of literature during the pandemic times. In fact, literature has been a kind of source, has been a kind of thing that goes with literature. The question that we have to ask here is, literature produces pandemic or pandemic produces literature? Means the two things, they are very interconnected, and I think the panelists, they will have their own opinions about this particular issue. But the webinar that Dr. Arvind Navle has organized here is very relevant during this time of crisis. And I thank him on behalf of all the panelists of this session for organizing this or such an event. I now request the panelists to come up with your views regarding the role that literature plays in the time of pandemic, maybe the time of COVID-19 or the times that we have, which the human history has seen different kind of pandemics. And during every time of pandemic, literature has played a great role in different ways. It has shaped the human lives in different ways. It has reflected the sufferings of the human beings during the times. Similarly, literature has also given a kind of inspiration for human beings to come out of this pandemic. I therefore now request the panelists to express their views.
Yes, Dr. Seema, Dr. Praveen Das, Basu, start. Dr. Seema, express your views.
All right. First of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Nagle for organizing this webinar and giving us an opportunity to connect with all the intellectuals whom otherwise it would not have been possible for us to interact. Secondly, it is such a timely intervention. We have completed the lockdown period. Now we are in the phase of unlock period. This is perhaps the second or the third day of the unlocking. The numbers that are being reported of coronavirus infected people from all over the country and the waves that are sweeping over the world. Some are getting out of it, the others are again finding themselves. You know, it is very difficult to make a sense of this whole thing. What initially began as seeing something on far off shores in China, suddenly we find it ourselves in the midst of this calamity. And how do we make sense of it? So, you know, and then by the time we could grasp the reality, the magnitude of the problem, we find ourselves in the lockdown. Now, this is the first time that anybody of this generation or the previous generation, or for that matter, the previous generation, has seen lockdown. We don't know what lockdown is of this magnitude. Confined within our homes in isolation, absolutely afraid for our lives, all the time worried, did I touch somebody? Did somebody, you know, has problem with their breath? You are afraid all the time. Even your family members you look at with suspect, you know, are suspect. The servants are out, the maids are out, the people, children are home. First of all, the problem is for us to come to terms with this reality. And then to tell children that, look, there is nothing to be afraid of. But from where do I get this courage? As a person of literature, I take refuge in not only reading literature, watching movies, but also writing my own literature in this period of time to make sense of this pandemic. What do? I go back to the, you know, 1918 is often referred to. All present problems are being seen in, in respect of the previous centuries pandemic that in 1918. But the problem is at that point of time, there was a world war raging all over the world. So the problem or the calamity or the problems, the loss that we faced couldn't be ascertained because it was not in isolation. And very little literature was written at that point of time because there was war raging and the people preferred to write about the war. So except for one or two texts of that period, we do not have much to refer back to that period. Also, India at that point of time was fighting, there was a freedom movement in India. And then another important thing, being a woman, that I would like to highlight at this point of time that I have noticed is, while reading about that period, it was women, basically, who at that point of time were the, you know, were most affected. And this time it's just the opposite. So why is this dichotomy? What has happened this time that women are not dying in the same numbers as they died or they were the primary victims? See, there was at that point of time, there was a famine in India. And women, as it is in a patriarchal society, they feed the members of the family first and then they eat. So perhaps their own immunities were compromised. And hence, you know, and they were also the primary caregivers of the people at home. So they were exposed to the disease. And secondly, their own immunities were not strong enough to tackle or to face or ward off the disease. So they died in great numbers. Another important thing about that point of time was it altered the course of history. How there was freedom struggle movement going on. The grassroots people, when they realized that the Britishers were not paying attention to the Indian people and all their focus was plant where the doctors were sent, where all the grains from that were being produced here in the country were being sent. So what was here? The people realized that they were on their own. So this, out of necessity, people gelled together at grassroots level. There was a lot of cohesion coming together of people. And then they finally found Gandhiji, and they thought that they would pitch all their force behind Gandhiji. So Gandhiji built a huge base over there in India. And therefore, that is, the rest is history, how he took us into up to the freedom of India. Now, when we look from this point of time, we do not have these pressing issues at the moment. Our concerns are basically about how we are confined in our homes and how we are dealing with those pressures, anxieties, worries, and of course, how we are trying to make sense of our own lives. But this is also an era when we have various other assets like the social media, the internet, where the news travels very fast. So we have another disadvantage that we also are tackling the rumor mongering that is going along with the, and which adds to the pressure that we are going undergoing at the moment. So there are a lot many issues that we are facing which were not there earlier, and other issues which were there earlier we are not facing. But we have to sift through the material, the literature available, to make some sense of our, for ourselves, and try to gain some courage, you know, to be able to, and strength to be able to deal with isolation, loneliness, fear, disease, and of course, you know, the poverty that is raging all around us. So I personally feel that literature, if we go back a little and address the issues and take some solace from literature and some directions from literature, then perhaps we will be able to find ourselves out of this pandemic and this problem.
Next, Basudha, Ravinda, Basudev Paul, voice your opinions. Mic, unmute mic.
Should I begin?
Yes, begin.
Yes.
Short but concise with one haiku.
Namaskar to everybody. Thank you, Arvind.
Thank you.
And I am not a bookish person. I have not prepared anything, but as per the topic, I want to ventilate my own experience in a subjective way. The role of literature in the times of crisis like coronavirus pandemic. Role of literature in order to understand any poet, any author, any dramatist, you should understand the inclination of the poet. If you understand the poet, then you will be able to understand his writings also. So role of literature. And you know, I quote Shelley, our sweetest songs are those that tell of saddest thought. What a fantastic line ever written in world literature. This is the role of literature. This is the healing task of literature. The shattering blow has suddenly descended on this beautiful planet Earth. What we discuss here purely based on conjectural probability. What happens hereafter has been a stunning question and a trillion questions thrust on us. The COVID-19, the experience, the frightful differences of opinions by different expertises on the deadly virus, whether this virus has been man-made is controversial. What we feel in apocalyptic, and this has been able to shake our age-old belief. The entire universe has been wounded to see the changes of this virus. Mankind helplessly observes the pandemic with a wonder tinged with fear. A fundamental change has been in the offing. The foundation of our aesthetic belief has been mercilessly shaken. The social setup has been wobbling since its eruption. What is in store for us no one knows. We human beings are truly helpless at the hands of the Almighty. Now, it is our fundamental duty as a responsible citizen to focus our much needed thought for the sustenance of our existence. And now, I quote two lines from Christopher Marlowe. Come live with me and be my love, and we will all the pleasures prove. So pandemic has an ruthless effect on every human beings, not only human beings, everything. We have been shrunk. We are inboxed. We are feeling boxed in. So the lockdown is still going on. Our mentality has also been locked down. And this virus, this unpredictable, unprecedented virus has done a lot of changes and still to come. And by now, during this pandemic period, so much has been written, so much has been palpable, but much better or much worse is to come. I don't know what will happen next, but since its declaration, a pandemic.
Smita, wish to interrupt you. Dr. Smita, ask, are you agree or not agree with Basudha? You mic, unmute mic.
I do agree. I'll make my comments.
No, I thought that you want to interrupt her. That's all. Okay, yes,
it's okay. No problem. Actually, I have not studied any books. I want to just share my own subjective feelings, what I have felt in this pandemic field. And you know, out of chaos, cosmos creates. Had there been no pandemic, there would have been no webinar like this. And there would have been no Arvind right now. And this is the amalgamation, this is the heterogeneous amalgamation of intellectual personalities over here. We had not got before. Pandemic is sudden. So many personalities I have observed, so many educationists, those who are sitting on the upper echelon of administration, they are telling these online classes are not possible. Online classes are not alternative. Yes, I do believe. You know, in ancient times, we had Guru Griho Shikha, Guru Griho. Rabindranath Tagore did not go to any formal education institution, but all the stalwarts, all the academic higher part had been there at his house. So that was another trend. And after our birth, we were used to blackboard teaching students, bands, formal, traditional. But suddenly pandemic has changed abruptly. It has changed our mentality also. And as a result, you know, pandemic has given us some good thing also. We are having interaction with literature. And one should remember, literature gave birth to language, and language can heal all sort of ills. I believe it.
Nice. I'll just make a few comments because my comments stretch further on to what Seema ma'am was trying to say. That I think.
Confused, ma'am. Just address Seema.
I think most of you will discuss literature, and as a sociolinguist, I would like to focus more on the sensationalist language that amplifies fear during this crisis. Yes. So I'm just stretching your point further. I think this is a classic, textbook example of contemporary globalization and of the processes that are happening, and then the way, you know, issues changes when we all become mobile. And we are not going to discuss economic effects of all of these here, but we can see the cultural effects. And as a linguist, I would like to focus or make some brief comments on the language of, the COVID narrative that is being seen in the media lately. mostly when the online, you know, it's a big engine behind all of this, and there are tons of memes and shout outs and conspiracy theories on social media that you can see, and you know, people are trying to find reliable sources of information, and there are intense discussions regarding such you know, information. But what I find myself in this situation, that there's a huge, you know, downside of this kind, that this sensationalist language that politicians are using, and this 24-hour news cycle that is really not helping. It's rather intensifying the threat that people have in their mind. So when the words like war or killer on the rise or killer on the loose used, it just amplifies the fear amongst people. And when this fear, like words like war are used, and then automatically the people look at the leaders and see what they are trying to do and how will they, you know, respond to, because someone needs to protect us, and how are the politicians, you know, trying to protect us. That sort of fear, people, and people look up to them. I can be, you know, in Britain, I can talk against my prime minister, who hasn't really, I mean, there's a feeling that he hasn't really responded the way some other global leaders have done, like Jacinda Ardern in New Zealand has responded. Words assure people. So the language that politicians use becomes of vital, you know, importance. We also see a wave of, you know, anti-Asian racism amongst, you know, during the epidemic. So people are getting that kind of feeling. So as a linguist, I want to look at the narrative that is being produced in the media throughout, and I find that will shape the literature for the future. And when we look at the global leaders, I mean, for me, can they rise to this new challenge? And you know, with their political skills, can they? How will they respond? And I think literature should make use of, you know, capturing this shift in the new normal and the new way of life. That's how I am observing it as a sociolinguist at the moment. I think that's all my comments on the linguistic aspect of this. Thank you. Any
Praveen Joshi.
Thank you.
Dr. Joshi. Taskar sir. Please.
I would like to thank to Dr. Navle for having this kind of debate on the role of literature. I would like to expand the theme. Why do we think only the literature? We should think about the humanities as the major branch of knowledge. Because of COVID-19 has changed the attitudes, perspectives of all the people, and we need to think about either psychology of the people, because of so many people, they are in need of some mental support. So we need to think about psychology. We need to think about social changes. We need to think about the economic changes. We have to reopen the pages of the history. For example, let me quote here. When we look at Albert Camus' The Plague, the novel also dealt with millions of the people dying, but each and every human being tries to survive. Here the question comes about, and we should know the difference between life and livelihood. Nowadays, everybody struggles, everybody thinks about his or her existence, and then thinks about the future, progress, changes, dreams, and all. So I feel that the present situation, though it is critical, though it's a crisis, but literature soothes the people, those who are ignorant. Literature teaches you how to live your life with full confidence. And nowadays, nobody talks about any kind of groupism. Nobody talks about any kind of caste and community. Everybody thinks about all people's existence. And exactly, literature has its own universal values. And nowadays or in future, perhaps the themes of the literary artists will be not concerned only with the COVID-19, but the COVID-19 will change the whole scenario of the world. Therefore, whatever the topic Navle sir has chosen, it needs to be expanded by crossing all the borders and boundaries of the discipline. And therefore, I feel that literature plays a very significant role, no doubt. But we need to think about literary history, or we need to think about other disciplines also. And one of the madam just she spoke before me, what she thought is right because of politicians, whether they are sensible enough or not, that is the big question. But that is their duty, to give the mental and economic support to those who are the victims of this pandemic situation. So each and every person who is in power, they have to think about the welfare of the society, irrespective of their political parties, irrespective of their positions. This is what I feel.
Thank you, sir. Navle sir, I would like to make one point here.
Okay. After that, I will highlight one point from Dr. Chaskar.
Okay.
That he spoke about the inadequacy of this. I don't find inadequacy as far as our limitations are concerned as a teacher of literature. Okay. I think that we have covered a whole area. No doubt, we have to think beyond this. Obviously, I do agree 100% with Dr. Chaskar that. But as a teacher, of literature, and as far as the scope of this seminar, this conference is concerned, I don't find any inadequacy here. With
it is
one of the attempts. It is very vast. It is a global scenario, global problem, and we have to think on every level, every front. Okay, means that I do agree with you, but I thought that I took the meaning of your word inadequacy in that sense. Okay, it is okay, no problem. Dr. Prashant, please.
Thank you, sir. Yes, respected professors and dear participants, thank you Shivaji College and the entire team of Dr. Arvind Navle sir for giving me an opportunity to be part of this august gathering. As really pointed out by the most respected speaker, Dr. Seema ma'am and Dr. Paul sir, and as our chairperson of today's session, Dr. Sarvadi sir, has raised one query that pandemic generate literature, or I think pandemic situation generate literature. It is worth reading pandemic text to better understand of our reactions to pandemic situations, like the text like Albert Camus, The Plague, as pointed out by dear Dr. Ashok Chaskar sir, and Stephen King's The Stand. There is another text by Stephen King's The Stand, brought readers' attention to the social, we can say, implication of the pandemic situation like plague, particularly isolation and failures of the state to either contain the disease or moderate the ensuing panic, we can say. Now the COVID-19 global pandemic has generated an abundance of research quickly. Lots of literature has generated during this pandemic situations. And here I would like to make one crucial point, being a student of language, and I would like to extend what Dr. Smita Ray ma'am has just pointed out, a great linguist. Okay, neither literature nor language exist without words. And since this COVID-19 situation came to India, there have been new terms emerging every now and days. And there are many more new terms, like nowadays we can see the new words like coronavirus, COVID-19, incubation period, or pandemic, community spread, quarantine, then forehead thermometer, lockdown, patient zero, screening, vaccine. And nowadays, the word sanitization has different kind of meanings. That's what I would like to say from a language point of view, particularly lexicological point of view. Thank you very much, sir.
I would like to bring your kind notice on the one word used by Dr. Basudev Paul also. He said that it is a sudden outburst. How many of you are agree that it is a sudden or it took a lengthy time to develop this thing, these things. That just I thought that is a very important point. Okay, just keep in your mind while putting your say. Next, Praveen Doshi. Dr. Kolekar. From Overseas Gorakhnath. Dr. Kolekar.
Sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, can
Gorakhnath, please.
Okay. Good evening, everyone, and namaskar from Saudi Arabia. I must thank Dr. Nawle, sir, for giving me this opportunity to be part of this panel. So the topic today in discussion, as we all know, is the role of literature in during the time of pandemics. So I want to add my points here. I feel that pandemics and epidemics, they are not a new phenomenon. Throughout our known human history, we had gone through different epidemics and pandemics, had faced all kinds of illnesses and diseases. In the times of pandemic in past, a good chunk of the literate population had taken refuge in books and literature. So the role of literature during the time of pandemic is threefold, according to me. The first thing is it should be descriptive. What I mean by descriptive is how the previous epidemics and pandemics were recorded in the books by the previous writers before us. The second role of literature is diagnostic. By diagnostic, I mean it's not only limited to the infections, doctors, deaths, you know, hospitals. Any epidemic or disease has deeper impacts on the society, on the well-being of society. And now we are watching on the television channels, and we are witnessing every day. We see there are a lot of social issues, social problems emerging in our country, especially India. There is a problem of migrant laborers. There's a problem of people losing jobs. You know, there is economic problem that country is facing. There is a global economic problem coming up. So this is what I mean by diagnostic. The third thing which the literature should do, it should prescribe things. Means the stand of the literature is prescriptive. It should instruct us. The literature should educate us, you know, what we should do during the time of pandemic and what we should not do during the time of pandemic. I want to take you into the history of the epidemics and pandemics with the help of the books that are available at our hand. Many novels from the past give us glimpses in the lives of people during the pandemic. For example, Daniel Defoe, he writes a journal of the plague year, which is considered a historical novel, and it was published in 1722. Defoe talks of the bubonic plague, which struck London in July 1665 in this book. The rules of lockdowns then were much similar like that we are going through now. So lockdown is not a new phenomenon. It may be for some people in today's world, maybe most young people, you know, but lockdowns existed before us. That's what this book tells us. You know, Defoe mentions that the lockdowns were there, even, and the rules of lockdowns were posted outside the church buildings. Now, like in Corona time, gatherings in public places, in taverns, public bars were prohibited. And also, like we face here, and we see that stadiums, sports centers, all were closed during that time. Defoe mentions in the book that many people in London did not take the epidemic seriously, just like people in the beginning of the outbreak of Corona in our country and worldwide. Okay, they were not serious. They were quite ignorant about the fact that the coronavirus is a deadly virus. They would roam around the alleys, Defoe writes, and lanes of London, throng the shops to buy stuff in spite of being at home. But some people among them followed the rules strictly. And he says that further in the book, by August 1665, plague took many waves, and it subsided by the end of December that year. And when it subsided, people came out on the street and they started praying and they started thanking God for that. The second book earlier, which was mentioned by our renowned panelists, that was Camus' Plague, Albert Camus' The Plague. Okay. So in that book, he mentions the epidemic of plague, which affected the Algerian city of Oran in the 19th century. He says that it came from animals to man, transmission of disease, animals to man. So we know that about corona, the fact that it has, kind of transmitted from animals to man in Wuhan, in the city of Wuhan. But Camus records that in the book called Plague, that the plague transmitted from animals to man. And he says that further in the book, that the city was full of dead mice. The city of Oran was full of dead mice. He knew that, in well advanced, he knew that what is coming, what difficulties they are going to get into. But the local leader, he says, of the city went on denying the epidemic-like situation in the city, but finally they agreed to it. I think the important character, the major character of the book is Dr. Rio Bernard, a character in the novel, who is the version of Camus himself. He speaks of how bravely the medic and paramedics fought the disease as they discharged their duty, just like in our times, how doctors and paramedical staff, they are working on the forefront and they are fighting against this corona pandemic. So we have to draw the parallels from the history. What we are doing now is exactly recorded in the books of literature, in the novels, in dramas, in poetry, in 18th century, 19th century, and 20th century. So he again goes on saying that he has read of the plagues in the past. He knew the history of the disease transmission from animals to humans. One of Camus' enemy in the novel is the Catholic priest, Penelou. And he appears to the city square and he gives a sermon and tells people that this disease, this virus, this plague disease is nothing but God's punishment for the depravity that we committed, for the sins we have committed. Even when in our present time, modern times, some religious gurus, they go on saying the same thing. They say that this is the wrath of God which has been inflicted on us. They say the same thing, which Camus mentions here, that the Catholic priest Penelou is trying to say. And later on, when the disease, the plague gets out of hand in the city of Oran, then the officials start enacting control measures in the city. And the language they use is optimistic in the notices, but downplay the seriousness of the situation. And he said, it describes the situation again. Camus says a special ward is opened at the hospital, but with limited beds. He says 80 beds to be precise. And the death, as the death toll begin to rise, more desperate measures were taken by the city council. And then he brings in the much fashioned word today, the home quarantines. The people were home quarantined in Oran, the corpses and burials are strictly supervised then also. A supply of plague serum finally arrives, and they were struggling to get the medicine. Just like now, many countries are struggling to get the medicine now, especially the medicines like hydroxychloroquine and remdesivir. But there is enough to treat, there is not enough medicine to treat the patients there, he says, in the city. And the country's emergency reserves are depleted completely. When the daily number of deaths jumps to 30, the town is sealed and an outbreak of plague is officially declared. And that was too late when it happens in Camus, the plague. So we have to learn from the experiences that these things, what we are going through, they have already been recorded in the 18th or 19th century by the writers then. I just want to, end my point with a beautiful poem, which was written by, it is debated actually, that Kathleen O'Mara. And this poem was written around the time of 1869, and it was republished during the Spanish flu time. This is a beautiful poem. The poetess explains what people did when they were inside their houses. She says that, and people stayed at home and read books and listened and they rested and did exercises and made art and played and learned new ways of being and stopped and listened more deeply. Someone meditated, someone prayed, someone made their shadow, and people began to think differently and people healed. And in the absence of people who lived in ignorant ways, dangerous, meaningless, and heartless, the earth also began to heal. And when the danger ended and people found themselves, they grieved for the dead and made new choices and dreamed of new visions and created new ways of living and completely healed the earth just as they were healed. So this is what we have to understand from the past recorded literature about the pandemics and epidemics. Even in the 20th century, the books for like, Jane Eyre and Dickens' novel, Bleak House, also there is a mention of epidemic and pandemic. So that is my point. So I just give it to the next panelist. Thank you.
There are some points raised by the participants also. I promoted one is from Cameroon, but I think that there is some problem, technical problem with the mic and all these. There is one more question was asked from one another country, and I answered her to come online. Some technical problem. Mm. We will tackle that things. Okay. There is one question also that Dr. Akshay Sarvade will ask, which is answered by me on text in the question answer. Okay, that one, he will take it. Okay, next turn, Dr. Kolekar. Dr. Kolekar, he's not able to listen. Yeah, Ankita, unmute your mic.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. And thanks a lot, Professor Naule, for giving me this opportunity. Pandemics, as we all know, are mass murderers. And diseases like plague, smallpox, and cholera, they ruin families, they destroy towns, and leave a generation that is scarred and scared both. The defeat of the science and medicine in which the people had placed their trust, they are only, you know, in these times, they are generating fear among the people. So as the earlier panelist said, that it is really a difficult time, a time of uncertainty. The world is living in the time of uncertainty, and the entire world is grappling with the spread of COVID-19. So it might be tempting to succumb to feelings of anxiety or helplessness. But in these times of uncertainty, we turn to literature because stories, poems, literature in general, it can help us make sense of those feelings and draw strength largely from the experiences of others. Throughout history and up to the present day, the authors, if we talk specifically about literature, they have grappled with epidemics and diseases in their work. Like some of our panelists have already mentioned, they've spoken about the authors and their works related to pandemics, from suspense thrillers, right, to tickling feelings that evoke our hopes and fears, and to profound and poetic narratives, you know, that reveal human condition. Literature has it is a combination. It comprises of everything that we are talking about, that we are discussing here. It has always held a prominent place in helping to define who we are as human beings and in enriching our lives. So this is all the more apparent during moments of crisis like the current COVID-19 pandemic. So if we talk about some of the works that were written in the earlier times. For instance, from, you know, Homer's Iliad to Stephen King's The Stand and Ling Ma's Severance, stories about pandemics have, over the history of Western literature, such as it is, offered much in the way of catharsis, way of processing strong emotions that all of us are feeling right now, and political commentary on how human beings respond to public health crises. Literature regards each individual with compassion and goes deeper than what, you know, mere statistics or historical records can tell us. It is not about quantifying things, rather it is about, you know, the feelings and the compassion that we you know, draw from literature. And definitely it has a vital role to play in framing our responses to crises like COVID-19. How do we respond to these times? And where do we draw the strength from to respond to these times? So if we talk about the, you know, range of literature from the classics to the contemporary novels, literature offers something in the way of uncertain comfort and a guide for what happens next. It may not explain away or fight off things such as pandemics, but it does become a source of consolation a way of sharing our common humanist concerns, and definitely it provides the deepest and most insightful records of events. And obviously the most important role played by literature is that it gives a reflection of society, its good things, bad things, all, whatever is happening. It really helps in better understand the time period, the current time that we are living in. It will be this period would be a literature, you know, in times to come. People will read about this, people will write about this. So literature, it offers hope to the people who are worried, lonely souls, the people who are fearful of an invisible virus. By combining the crisis and the joyous breakthrough moment, the glorious resolution. And the role of literature during crisis like this is also to teach us not to forget, to notice the important moments of connection while sheltered in place, moments that may last beyond the recovery. Literature also shows us that there are other ways to live during pandemics, and also help us understand that communality is a necessity. Through literature, we can hope that this ability to reshape life will be something that is taken away from this crisis. We will see new ways, we will see better ways of relating to one another that won't be determined by the crisis, but will be a result of the creativity we can see that is possible in our new ways of living. So whether you are looking for historical context about pandemics, scientific information about the spread of illness, or comfort, literature dopes provide respite and illumination amid the anxiety of current developments. It is believed that words and ideas do change the world. And I think Prashant Mote sir spoke about this. And so I completely agree to what he said. And I believe literature within it carries infinite depth of words. And it gives birth to innumerable ideas to change the world. And so I think the role of literature during such crisis is as important as any other branch of knowledge on earth, if not more. There's a beautiful line by Robin Williams, and I would like to conclude with this beautiful quote. And I quote, "We don't read and write poetry because it's cute. We read and write poetry because we are members of the human race. And the human race is filled with passion. And medicine, law, business, engineering. These are noble pursuits and necessary to sustain life. But poetry, beauty, romance, love, these are what we stay alive for." And I unquote. And thank you so much for listening to me. Hello.
Yes.
Lovely, sir.
Yeah.
Yes. Saruda sir, please ask him, who is the Praveen Doshi, Dr. Praveen Doshi.
Sir, you Joshi sir, your voice is not audible.
Yeah. No. You are is unmute till our voice is not coming. Till there, Dr. Kodekar, what technical problem you have? You are not audible.
Joshi is invisibly visible.
Yeah. Dr. Kodekar, Dr. Thiru,
yes,
Shali,
Dr. Pravinda.
No, we are unable to listen you. We are not able to listen you, Dr. Praveen Joshi. Okay, till Dr. Thiru.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, start, put your say.
Yes, sir. Good evening, yeah. Everybody on the line. In the inception, I would like to thank Dr. Navale sir for inducting me in the panel. I'd like to say something about the role of literature. Literature, while dealing with this conflicting times, suggests that all of us must band together to fight evil. Whether the evil is a cause of pandemic, such as a novel coronavirus outbreak, or whether the evil deeds are perpetrated by a few who stoke the fire of hatred in the end, we should stand united to resist and endure. As John Donne said, no man is an island, entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. Any man's death diminishes me because I'm involved in mankind. And therefore, never send no to for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. Literature, while responding to pandemics, highlights the endurance of human beings. I can say even stoic endurance of human beings. The mixed human feelings that the pandemic evoke, and also the socio-economic, psychological impact of pandemic on humanity, irrespective of man-made borders and norms. Here, I would like to quote Arundhati Roy. Arundhati Roy writes about pandemic, that pandemic is a gateway between one world and the next. We have the choices before us to walk through lightly with little luggage, ready to imagine another world. So we have to build healthy habits, resilience, particularly mental resilience, and connections in our unprecedented time. That's all I want to share with you. Thank you.
Is technical problem solved, Dr. Joshi?
Am I audible to you now?
Yeah. Now
yes,
you're
yes.
Audible.
Very good.
Carry on.
That's good. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
One minute. Okay, there, one from Cameroon.
Was listening to everybody, and it was really great pleasure to listen to all of you. And wonderful views have been expressed by our panelists. And congrats to Dr. Arvind that he has been, so instrumental in organizing such a wonderful gathering here. Literature is there to educate us, to inform us, to give us pleasure. And it has always been seen that politics divides and literature unites. I remember the lines of Rabindranath Tagore, where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, and the world where knowledge is free, and the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls. These are the wonderful lines, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls. When he says narrow domestic walls, that also includes geographical areas. So literature always transcends all positions, like region, like country, geographical areas, and everything. These are all political demarcations. Literature has always taught human beings to be united, to come together. Now, with the spread of advanced technology everywhere, we can come together. But earlier, there were books which reached almost every country. And through books, we would know the other countries, their culture, their society, their custom, their traditions, and everything. So it has always been the effort of literature to be constructive, to play a constructive role. It has always inspired. It has always motivated. It has always boosted the morale of people in every kind of circumstances. It may be pandemic, it may be epidemic, it may be floods, there may be earthquakes, whatever it may be. Literature always brings you face with, and even if certain negative things, certain bad things are mentioned in literature, even if the negative side of human life is reflected in literature, it is not for us to look at that side from the point of adopting those things in our life. We read books and the negative aspect of human life to bring about a kind of catharsis so that we realize what reality is and we become face to face with reality. Now, when this pandemic is here, I remember the novel by Ahmad Ali. Ahmad Ali, 1918, has written Twilight in Delhi. And what he has described there is seen even today. But it was also an effort to help humanity to rise above the pandemic, above the negativities of life, about the disorders of life, and rise above such things like pandemic and epidemic and have hope in life, have promise in life. As Ankita has said, that literature always gives hope. Literature promises us that good days will always come. Now our minds are full of negativity, but I'm sure that after reading the literature, that will come up, that will emerge in the days to come. We will rise above all these negativities, and again our positive mindset will be framed and will be easy for us. So
net connection problem.
Again problem. If winter comes, can spring be far behind? This line, this single line gives us a lot of comfort, lot of soothing, lot of promise, lot of hope. Thank you very much.
Dr. Kodekar, you left? Dr. Kodekar, are you able to listen to me? Am I audible to you? Okay, who left? Dr. Gurav?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes. Talk a bit loudly.
A very warm good evening to all of you all. Am I audible, sir? Please, can I get your ear?
Yes. Talk loudly.
I wish to thank you, sir, for giving me an opportunity to express my views. And a very warm good evening to all the dignitaries present on the dais across that side. I would like to discuss about, we all have discussed that, yes, how literature plays an important role. Now, let me come down to the solutions. Are we thinking about the solutions? So many books were written in the past, right? Then why are we still remaining so unprepared to face this kind of pandemics? Why are still these women are suffering from violence? Or why animals are left on the roads like that only? Or they're not attended? They're kept without giving food, or they're even killed. Even the domestic animals, the pets are left on the roads. So we know that, yes, literature plays an important role. It acts as a catharsis in this kind of time. But then how are we going to find out solutions? What are we going to give our children, this present generation or the future generation? They are looking at us with great hope that if this is so scary, how are we going to solve the problem? See, a lot of solutions were written in the past pandemic literature also, that distancing was done. Even Chaucer has written how they got together, told stories, how they supported each other. Even Torudat wrote Life of Tree, when she suffered from tuberculosis and she passed away. Entire family was swiped away in the tuberculosis pandemic. So what have we learned from this? Have we learned to solve the situation? Have we learned to face the situation? Or are we just going to say, yes, the books are written or these things are written? How are we going to face the situation now? Even though now we are given some concession, okay, we can move out. Nasik still is under lockdown and we are still facing problems in some area. The number is rising, violence is rising. How are we going to face this situation? So UN has called for a meeting, a general meeting. Yes, we really need to revisit again and read the literature. Let us again syllabus should be again reframed. Some literature should be added to this, where we can teach our children, yes, this is the situation, not to panicky. We can have social distancing. We can have these kind of precautions can be taken. Don't worry. And then we can move ahead in the further life. So I think we also need to look at the solution. There are questions on this side in the chat box, which are asking about like how the women still are suffering. It's not that the number has come down or something like that, but the women are suffering. There is a lot of problems that are going on. And still we are not able to learn from the literature. We are not able to go across. There are two groups which are formed, which are talking about that. Yes, online teaching should be there. Others are saying online teaching should not be there. So how are we going to deal with this, all this situation? Yeah, definitely literature plays the role of giving us mental, physical relief little after reading how those people face the situation. It also gives us a lot of, you could say, little kind of support, you could say moral support. But then I think at the end, we also need to find out solution when again and again pandemics are coming up. Are we ready to face it? Are we really prepared? We still remain unprepared after reading so many books and so many poems. How will our children have confidence in us? How will they look upon us? Will they have that much of courage? Yes, to face the next pandemic, which will surely come after a decade, or maybe I don't know what number of years it will take. So we need to give them kind of a support. Yeah, thank you so much. I just wanted to point out this. We all as educators, I think we should come together, plan something, reframe the syllabus. Let us take some literature from there. Let us keep our students and children and even the society and even everybody who is around us. And let us all together, let us come together and face this issue. Thank you so much. Now, let's sir.
Dr. Kodekar seems online now. Just see, he came online. Dr. Kodekar? What technical problem? I don't know is being happened with him. Okay, Vishali, is your OHO?
Yeah, sir.
Please put your say.
Good evening to all of you.
In the course of time, Dr. Kodekar will come online.
Yes, sir. Good evening to all of you. Thank you so much, sir, for giving.
Take mic close. Vishali, take your mic a bit close.
Yes, I'm audible.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, good evening to all of you. And thank you so much, sir, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. According to me, literature has always been used to predict future events. And even pandemics of different types have been predicted through the lenses of literature. I want to share one example here. I mean, this Boccaccio's book, Decameron, in which, you know, he wrote it when there is a pandemic outbreak around 1348. And he wrote in this book in order to guide the Italians and on how to manage their cognitive well-being during the situation of epidemic. And hence we can say this thing that literature has always been used to predict the arrival of pandemic. And it has also taught us how to react and how not to react to the pandemic when it comes. But the issue is that as the situation has become a global phenomena, there shouldn't be any form of pretense as if nothing is happening. That is, as the world is, you know, trying to seek solution to this global crisis, we should not underreact to the situation. And also there shouldn't be an overreaction as well. Rather, as you know, literature has always been used to prophesy the pandemic, and it can also teach us how to respond to it. And however, there has been different responses to this novel pandemic. There have been also, you know, economic responses, medical responses, socio-political responses. But in line with this study, I mean, there is going to be a full concentration on literary response. And in this sense, different stories are told through the lenses of literature, but it is very essential to know which story to accept and which one to discard. And at this time, it is, you know, very essential to read the stories created by different writers and examine the stories and then identify how literature has been able to respond to this global pandemic. Hence, in the process, as, you know, literary persons, we should study our experience. And how do we cognize and reflect these experiences in various ways? For example, psychologically, physiologically, especially in this time of crisis. And all these are expected to be brought under focus to reflect how this literary response appears. And thus, as we begin to examine different literary texts on this crisis, it is very, you know, essential to think of what these texts speak to us about this pandemic. As we continue to examine these texts, they are related with our experiences because they have a direct communication with our practical experiences of the crisis. Then we begin to think about what these experiences can produce in order to provide us a solution. And in this situation, it is very essential to use literature to search for the source of the problem. And in the process of this investigation, you know, we try to find solutions to the crisis through literature. And but obviously, I mean, there is always people are, you know, engaged in blame game after tracing the source of the crisis. But in this case, we can begin to use literature to reflect the intensity of human predicament and how people react to this human predicament during this crisis. And but it is very, you know, it is good to understand that we are in the world where we need to learn about how people react to the event that occurs. By this virtue, we are bound to make a choice on how to face the crisis. And to crown it all, humanity should become the most important factor in which we use in responding to the crisis, especially when it has to do with environmental relationship with and improvement of humanity. And in the whole process, hopefully the solution to this crisis will be discovered soon. So that is all I mean. I want to share, sir.
Dr. Sarvade, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, I think that there is a problem with Dr. Koyekar's system. Okay.
Dr. Koyekar, yes.
Because time we have exceeded to our set of time.
Yeah.
You make your comments and preside
over. We have crossed the time.
No.
One thing that I would like to, I can't see the questions that are asked by the audience. If you have the questions with you, will you please ask them, raise them before the panelists so that we have a short discussion on the questions and then we will then later on proceed to my observations. Hello?
Yeah, you are audible. Carry on.
Hello? So what I said means since I have signed in from my mobile, I can't see the questions raised by the audience. If it is possible for you, if you raise them in the session, we will have a brief discussion on those questions and then later on we will proceed to my observation. Will that do? Will you please raise the questions asked by the audience?
I promoted them, but I don't know what happened. They went back off screen. I can read even though.
Okay.
There is a one, what is name? Akem Henry from University of Bua. She is asking, I don't know he or she, okay. Akem Henry. Is it true that literature should be both representative of the present context and prescriptive to posterity, showing how to deal psychologically and socioculturally with pandemics? How can literature help the present state of the infected and affected in the society? This is a question I think that it is covered by most
already.
Of the panelists.
Yeah, okay. Already most of the panelists have talked about most of the panelists have already talked about the situation and they have shown how exactly literature can be a hope too.
Dr. Sarvade, there is one point. Dr. Shima raised her hand.
I just before this esteemed panel, I want to make a submission that till now we have looked at literature only retrospectively. But what is important is to see present pandemic as a cradle of new literature that would be created, just as we during partition. We had for 30, 40 years, we had these waves of partition literature that flooded the society. So this period is also very important. It is not just benefiting from the last previous pandemics, But this is a cradle where new literature would be, you know, genesis of new literature will happen. And maybe directions from the past literatures, maybe not. Because, you know, today Times of India reported that they already have a new genre, which is called lockdown literature.
Yes.
And, you know, it is making debut on WhatsApp, and then it is being published. Some of it is being self-published and the text being downloaded. So we have to, when we factor in, we have to move ahead with the times as well and look at the construction of literature, the genesis of literature from current perspective into future as well. And maybe later on, we might also have Twitter as, you know, micro texts, tweets as micro texts in literature. So every day, the dynamics of literature is changing in this fast-paced technological era. And we need to factor in those things as well. And so there is already, you know, there are problems of writing literature in this time, but there are a lot of books that have already hit the stands, which are being promoted as lockdown literature. So that is the submission that I wanted to make in front of all the panelists. Thank you for allowing me.
Jaskar also has his hand.
No, it's okay.
Dr. Jaskar, please, what do you say, please?
No, just...
Dr. Jaskar want to say something?
No, sir. Just proceed.
Yeah, I thought that you... Yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. I thank all the panelists for...
My department colleague, Mane, you want to ask something? Yes. Please.
Hello, am I audible, sir?
Ask Dr.
Mane,
you want to
sir?
Ask something?
Yeah.
Please, audible. Please ask.
Am I audible?
Ask or put your say.
Okay, sir.
Put your say. What do you think about this topic?
Sure, sir. Gives my breast 1,000 pains, can make me feel its passion, which it feigns. Enrage, compose with more than magic art. With pity and fear, tear my heart, and snatches me over the earth, through the air, to Thebes, to Athens, when he will and where. I think literature has a task, and that task is to affect. Actually, right now, in the era of information and technology, we are not getting affected by the literature. We are getting affected by WhatsApp and these all mediums are there. If we consider BET, the story, at the initial stages, when the lockdown began, we went to movies, we went to theaters, we went to television, WhatsApp and these all things. After 1 month and a half, we got fed up with these all things. After a particular time of lockdown, the people are going to read. They're not going to go to WhatsApp and these all things. These modern equipments, they are going to bore everybody. Okay, so after this lockdown and pandemics, these are going to be helpful for literature also, first thing. Second thing I want to quote or tell, it is only the God and beast can live in solitude. Only the God and beast can live in solitude. After this solitude, gods are going to emerge. They are going to come out. So many travel stories are there in India. The people traveled by foot, on foot for nearly 400 kilometers, 500 kilometers. After the end of this pandemic, maybe in the next 5 years or 10 years, I think there would be so many travelogues are going to be there. The sufferings that people had gone through. And not only that, so many diaries are also going to be there. People are now going to accept this, that in the end, as like in the story BET, we are going to turn back to the reading.
Problem, I think so.
And most important, it is about the affectation theory I'm going to speak about.
Problem.
That's all.
Okay. Butte, you want to say something?
Yeah, I just want to say that literature has been always a mirror of society, right from the plague and all the epidemics and pandemics. And recently we have faced Ebola-like pandemic. And this is the way we are facing day-to-day life. And that can be reflected surely from the point of view of the emerging writers. And they will show their views, their whatever they think about it from their literature. And this is the platform and this is the opportunity for the new writers. Surely they will express themselves to express about such kind of pandemics. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. Saroja, now you proceed, please, because time is...
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Naval. Now, we are
make your brief slide over the session.
Now, see, we know the gravity of the situation today. Almost 50 lakh people across globe, they are affected due to this crisis. And all of us, the humanity, is now aware of the intensity of the problem. The lives are changed, as has been pointed out by many panelists. The lives of human beings have changed to a great extent. Different terms like lockdown and, as Dr. Prashant Modi was talking about, different terms are introduced to deal with and to talk about the situation. Well, they are there. But I, in the beginning, raised the question, is literature creating pandemic or pandemic creating literature? The thing, of course, pandemic can create literature, that has been proved. We know, means I think a speaker, Dr. Gorakhnath Gangane, has talked about the threefold role of literature, and he has shown with concrete examples, the novel of Camus, how exactly pandemic has created literature. And COVID, the crisis, COVID crisis that we are going through, will also change, will also be responsible for new literature in the coming years. That is true. But literature creates pandemic. In this particular phrase, I have changed the meaning, the scope of the word literature. Because, see, one of the panelists, she referred to the blame game. And the blame game is nothing but literature. And the blame game goes on differently. Who created corona? Whether it is man-made, artificial, prepared in a lab, or is it coming out of the animals, as one of the panelists has referred to? That is the question. And this has also created kind of pandemic. The pandemic that we have, we are now living in, corona, one thing is clear. Earlier, we were boasting of our humanity, that we are now modern and living in postmodern times. And if we, while facing the corona issue, corona problem, coronavirus, we have realized that we are not postmodern at all. Rather, we are left to a very primitive kind of stage, because we cannot identify a solution even after 6 months from the crisis of this coronavirus. That underlines the problem, or let us say the vulnerability of human beings, as and when the new virus comes, new let us say danger comes on humanity in general. So that what we find. One more thing, as you might be knowing, that we have plague literature. Plague has played a great role in bringing about literature of different times. One of the participants she was referring to, Decameron, the Italian text. And the way such crisis has played. So we talk of the time before plague and time after plague. Time before plague is Renaissance period, and plague period after plague is Renaissance period, because Renaissance has taught us to deal with plague. So that what we may know. And what I think is, means after this one, we have to talk of, use the same terminology. We can talk of pre-corona times and post-corona times. What are the times earlier? The intensity of this disease is very severe, as compared to Ebola, as compared to swine flu, or any other disease so far. We have not experienced lockdown to this extent of 2, 3, 4 months times. So that underlies the intensity of the problem. In fact, that is what I think, Miss. This is what my own opinion is, that we have to think of literature in terms of, or think of world in general, in terms of pre-corona and post-corona times. Post-corona times will make us change different things differently. Our way of life is going to change. So say, for example, the sanitization kind of thing, the market is now getting open. But with sanitization, we have to change. Means the lives are changing. And this will definitely reflect in literature. I think, Dr. Mohini Guro, She referred to the need of changing, both Mohini Guro and Vishali Sharma, both of them, they referred to the need of changing syllabus. The present day syllabus that we have, the traditional text and the traditional kind of thing that we teach to the students, but we need to be choosy. Though there are the evidences of pandemic in the literature, Vishali Sharma, she talked about the criteria that we have to think of while choosing and prescribing a text. The syllabus that we have and that we need to teach to our students, that needs to be changed, and that is the post-corona effect, the post-corona times. Well, I'm very happy with the submissions and the presentations that the panelists have given. Dr. Seema Roy, she referred to the thing that women are not the primary victims of this corona times. So, in fact, this is the first time she referred to the good immunity of women. That is, of course, absolutely true. I'm not talking against it. But at the same time, the lockdown kind of thing, when all the members of the house, they are in the house itself, it made a lot of demand on the women of the house, and that also needs to be considered. And literature in the coming times, it will definitely give views of or give picture of this kind of thing. Dr. Basudev Pao, he referred to Shaili's quote, Shaili's line, and he has stated that the aesthetic foundation of us is going to be changed, and that is absolutely true. This is post-corona times, and our aesthetic will definitely change during this one. Dr. Smita Rai and Dr. Prashant Mote, they talked about corona and language. What exactly corona has given to language, and language has changed accordingly. Means, I particularly liked Smita's point that the narratives produced by the politicians during this time, they will be the source of literature in future. And that is absolutely true. She also referred to the increased fear in the mind of the people due to the words like killer and thrill. So that is absolutely, I do agree with you, ma'am. Similarly, Prashant Mote, he talked of the neologisms, new words that are formed during this time. And any situation, any time, whenever human being, they face a crisis, you find that new words, they are generated. During every phase, every new phase, new words are generated. Dr. Chaskar from Pune University, He underlined the need to transcend the discipline. Of course, this attempt, Dr. Arvind Navle has already mentioned, answered this point, that since we all are from literature fraternity, we are talking about literature and pandemic times. So, but literature includes all disciplines, I think so, because literature is the mirror of life. If it is mirror of life, all disciplines, all domains, facets of life, they are reflected in literature, and that explains how this literature is going to deal with different times, different dimensions of new post-corona period. So that is a good point that is raised by Dr. Chaskar and answered by Dr. Navle. Gurunath Gangane, I appreciate his threefold role that literature plays. He referred to descriptive, diagnostic, descriptive role of literature, diagnostic role of literature, and prescriptive role of literature. Very good analysis, Gangane sir. I congratulate you for that. Dr. Ankita Khanna, she specifically talked about literature, and she refers to it as a mass destructor. A new word, a neologism, corona as a mass destructor, or pandemic as mass, in fact, when the pandemic, the meaning of pandemic is itself mass destructor, but she has well phrased it, mass destructor. And this time of uncertainty, uncertainty, only literature can be a solace. Whenever we have a time of uncertainty, literature provides a lot of solace, and it is a kind of hope that she argues, and I do agree with what she said. Dr. Thiru from Vellore, he has also talked about literature, and he has shown the examples. He referred to different texts from history that have talked about pandemic of different times. He talked of Dunn, he talked of even Arundhati Roy. And he has said that literature will definitely help us come overcome this particular pandemic situation. Dr. Praveen Doshi, he made the argument that pandemic times or literature during pandemic times makes man come together. And that is a kind of, that is the relevance of humanity. Why we call humans as humanity? That is the reason. So this humanity, coming together of human beings, helping each other, that is what literature teaches us. And that has been focused by Dr. Praveen Doshi. Literature will definitely help us come out of this pandemic. This assertion made by Dr. Doshi has his quite confidence in his particular this phrase. Is absolutely a kind of acceptable argument. Dr. Mohini Gura, I already pointed out her this one argument that she needs to, she argues that we need to reframe the syllabus. And that is, I do agree with you, ma'am. And literature, of course, it teaches us. But the thing is that we have to learn from it. Can we be able to learn from literature and help us, help our future generations to cope up with the pandemic situations, that the possible pandemic situations in future. Dr. Vishali Sharma, the last speaker, she talked about, she said that, she made a point that literature is a full account of pandemic every time. Literature definitely, it covers all aspects, because see, pandemic is not one thing. It affects different areas of life, different walks of life. And writers coming from different sections, they will focus on different areas. And literature in, it will be a full account of pandemic times. And that is absolutely true. We need to, she says, we need to think of a criteria for selecting a particular text. There are so many texts that talk of pandemic or that are the output of the pandemic times. But we have to think of a criteria to select a particular text when we prescribe it for our future generations. I, in fact, appreciate the contributions, submissions given by all the panelists. And I'm quite confident that whatever the arguments that are put forward by our contribution, our panelists, they will definitely help the humanity, the not only the participants of the seminar, but all the, that is webinar, all the participants of the webinar, because it is live on YouTube too. All the parts, but all humanity in general, because the webinar like this one, it will again underline with bold the relevance of literature in human beings, in the lives of human beings. And that is what I think. With this, I conclude my speech. I thank the organizer for asking me to, or giving me an opportunity to chair the panel session. I now hand it over to Dr. Navle.
Thank you, Dr. Very, you have covered all the says and the points raised by all the panelists. Okay, very nice to listen to you. Now we are near about 45 minutes ahead. No problem. This is our last session. Now I would like to request to my colleague, Vice Principal of the College, Head of the Society Department of Sociology, Dr. R.M. Manzare, to propose vote of thanks of this presentation. Dr. Manzare.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Good evening, one and all. This is Dr. Manzare. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this very good panel session. I, on behalf of KSP Mandals, Shivaji Mahavidyalaya Udgir, Maharashtra. First of all, I would like to propose hearty thanks to chairman of this panel discussion, Honorable Dr. Akshay Sarvadesa. His very informative session and very useful information to give us. I would also like to thanks to all panelists, that is all honorable, Dr. Smita Rai, Goraknath Ganganesa, Dr. Praveen Joshi, Dr. Ashok Chaskar sir, Dr. T. N. Kolekar sir, Dr. Ankita Sharma, Sri Basudev Paul sir, Dr. Seema Kathiyar, Dr. S. Thiruvanakasaru, Dr. Prashant Mothe, Dr. Mohini Gura, and Dr. Vishali Sharma for making excellent presentations and making this discussion very brainstorming. I would like to express our profound gratitude to our principal, Dr. V. H. Jadhav, sir, his presence in this panel discussion. I will also thank to our very hard worker, very enthusiastic convener, Dr. A. M. Navle, sir, to organize this session and also this unique conference. I would like to also thanks to my colleague, Mr. P. D. Mane, sir, Dr. Gutte, sir, his presence here. And lastly, but not least, I would like to thanks all participants, his presence here for the his panel session. I would like to thanks all, one and all, very thanks to presence here. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, with kind permission, my principal is here. With my kind permission of the principal and the chairperson, may I close the session? I salute. I'm thankful for his patience. That he is not from literature. He is from statistics faculty. Okay, till very interestingly, very attentively, he has never closed even his video. Okay, namaste.
Thank you.
Namaste.
Thank you.
Namaste. Thank you. Bye. Thank you. See you.